Good afternoon, everyone. It gives me immense warmth and great pleasure to grace all your occasion, all your presence. I welcome you all to this webinar on updates on ovarian cancer. It is a glorious moment to extend my warm wishes on behalf of EIC, ESIC, MC, and PGIMSR, Departments of Obstetrics and Gynecology. I want to convey my heartfelt gratitude to the chairpersons for accepting the invitation and presiding over this seminar on updates on ovarian cancer. I now welcome Dr. Sampath Kumari ma'am and Dr. Mohan Ambal ma'am to chair the session. Professor Dr. S. Sampath Kumari ma'am, now presently Chief and HOD of Muthukumaran Medical College and Research Institute, Chennai. She was a FOCSI Vice President and retired Deputy Director and Professor of IOG, MMC. She was a receiver of Karmaveer Chakra 2015 National Award for Adolescent Activities. Dr. S. Mohan Ambal ma'am, she is retired. Dr. M. Mohan Ambal ma'am, she is retired director of IOG Egmore and HOD of Obstetrics and Gynecology. She is presently professor of OBG in ESIC, MCA, PGIMSR, KK Nagar, Chennai. She was a past president of OXI and Perambur branch. Now over to the chairpersons. Dr. Sampath Kumari ma'am.
Yes, Mohan Ambal madam will start, I think. Madam, good afternoon to all. Mohan Ambal madam, Dr. Maya,
hello.
Yes, madam, we can hear.
Yes, introduce me. Introduce Dr. Gayatri, please. Sampath Kumari.
Yes, madam. Good afternoon to all. First of all, I thank Dr. Maya, Dr. Mohan Ambal madam, and ESI team for giving me an opportunity. As all of us know, this ovarian cancer, it is the 8th most common occurring cancer in the women and 18th of all cancers. The incidence being 1.7 to 15.2. See, we see with the CA cervix and endometrium, we screen with the pap smear and endometrial sampling. This ovarian, most of the time, only 15% is diagnosed at the early stages. And the death due to ovarian cancer is again, it is increased. So now we can hear the speakers about the incidence, prevalence, pathology, and the treatment. First, I have a pleasure of introducing Dr. Gayatri. She is an assistant professor in ESI. She did her UG in Stanley and PG in ZIPMA. She is trained in lab and presented papers in FOCSI. Back to Dr. Gayatri.
Yes, Gayatri. Gayatri, start.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, madam. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm here to present the epidemiology, clinical presentation, screening, and staging of ovarian cancer. Ovarian cancer, as we all know, is one of the common gynecological cancers, third after cervical and uterine cancer. It has a worst prognosis with the highest mortality rate. The lifetime risk is approximately 1 in 70. The worldwide number of new cases is being added is 2,50,000 every year. And it's one of the five leading sites of cancer and contributes to around 10 to 15% of gynecological cancers in India, with the incidence of epithelial ovarian tumors being 9 to 17 per 100,000. Malignant tumors of the ovaries can occur at all ages, but histological type varies according to the age. Less than 20 years, germ cell tumors usually predominate. Borderline tumors occur between the age of 30s and 40s. Invasive epithelial ovarian cancers occur mostly after the age of 50, with the highest incidence between 60 to 64 years. 23% of gynecological cancers are ovarian in origin, but it contributes to around 47% of gynecological cancer-related deaths. The incidence of ovarian cancer varies across the world, and this epidemiological diversity is due to the varying risk factors in different parts of the world. The prevalence of ovarian cancer is highest in the non-Hispanic white women with around 12 per 100,000 and less in Asian Pacific Islander women of around 9.2 per 100,000. And this is a pie chart showing ovarian cancer distribution by age. And we could see as age advances, the incidence of ovarian cancer increases highest after the age of 55 years. And now discussing about the risk factors of ovarian cancer. As age advances, the risk of ovarian cancer increases and it's more after the age of 45 years. Nulliparous and women of low parity due to incessant ovulation are predisposed to develop ovarian cancer. Women with previous polycystic ovarian syndrome or on ovulation induction drugs due to hyperestrogenism, high calorie, high fat diet intake, and family history with genetic predisposition of BRCA1 and BRCA2 gene mutations, early menarche and late menopause, and multiple cycles of ovulation induction with endometriosis can predispose to ovarian cancer. Breastfeeding, multiparity, during which we have a long period of anovulation, are protective against ovarian cancer. And the use of oral contraceptive pills for at least 5 years will reduce the incidence of ovarian cancer to around 40 to 50%. The beneficial effect lasts for around 10 years even after stoppage of the pills. Now discussing the clinical presentation of the ovarian cancer. Approximately 2/3 of all epithelial ovarian cancers are around stage 3 or stage 4 at diagnosis. The presenting symptoms include abdominal pain or discomfort, menstrual irregularities, dyspepsia, which may be present only for a few weeks. But as the disease progresses, abdominal distension and discomfort with ascites gradually worsens, and respiratory symptoms do start due to an increased intra-abdominal pressure or from the transportation of fluid into the pleural cavities. Abnormal vaginal bleeding is usually unusual. Serous fallopian tube and peritoneal cancers present in the same way as ovarian cancer. A detailed medical history must be taken from the patient to ascertain the possible risk factors, history of other cancers, and history of cancer in the family, followed by a complete physical examination, including general breast, pelvic, and rectal examination to be performed. Patients with epithelial ovarian cancers confined to the ovary or fallopian tube at initial diagnosis at stage 1 usually have a very good prognosis. But as the symptoms are often very insidious and the duration of symptoms are not very different between early stage and advanced stage disease. Grade 1 serous mucinous and endometrioid cancers are usually early stage of presentation. But high grade serous cancers are most often stage 3 because of early dissemination by a more aggressive tumor. And tumor markers for germ cell tumors must be done for younger patients less than 40 years who have a pelvic mass or a suspicious enlargement of the ovary. The majority of women with epithelial ovarian cancer will have vague and non-specific symptoms. They might have abnormal vaginal bleeding, or it can be a postmenopausal bleeding, or they may present with urinary frequency and constipation. And some do rarely present with lower abdominal distension, pressure, pain, or dyspareunia. Acute symptoms because of pain due to rupture or torsion is usually not seen. In advanced stage disease, they present with abdominal distension, bloating, constipation, nausea, anorexia, and early satiety due to the presence of ascites, omental metastasis, or bowel metastasis. Go et al. Has designed the ovarian cancer symptom index, and he has reported that when pelvic or abdominal pain, urinary frequency or urgency, increased abdominal size or bloating, and difficulty eating or feeling full, when present for less than 1 year and occurring for longer than 12 days a month, has a sensitivity of 56.7% for early ovarian cancer and 79.5% for advanced stage disease. And the symptoms used in this by Go et al. In the symptom survey are the symptoms related to pain, eating symptoms, abdominal symptoms, bladder symptoms, bowel and menstrual irregularities, and pain during intercourse, and symptoms like leg swelling and difficulty breathing. But only those symptoms are found to have a good sensitivity and specificity. The signs of ovarian cancer, as we all know, is a bilateral and fixed solid mass. Ascites may be present, metastatic nodules which may be palpable per abdomen, nodules in the pouch of Douglas, and rarely women present with signs of paraneoplastic syndrome. Now, about screening for ovarian cancer. Till now, we do not have any documented effective screening method that will reduce the mortality of ovarian, fallopian tube, or peritoneal cancers. Studies using CA-125, ultrasound of pelvis, and pelvic examination do not have an acceptable level of sensitivity and specificity. And it has been, studies have been carried out in general population and also in high-risk population. The risk of ovarian cancer algorithm is one of the ways for screening women for ovarian cancer, and it is intended for use mainly in postmenopausal women between the age of 50 and 85, and women who are considered to be at high risk of ovarian cancer due to the family history or genetic cause. And this test is a quantitative algorithm that uses a woman's age, menopausal status, personal ovarian cancer risk status, and serum CA125 levels. And they compare a woman's individual longitudinal profile of the CA125 results over time with the known profiles of women prior to diagnosis of ovarian cancer and women without ovarian cancer to provide an accurate risk of having the disease. And it is a multimodal ovarian cancer screening strategy. And after the test, the women are triaged into three categories as normal, intermediate, or elevated. Normal score recommends a test in 1 year's time. Intermediate recommends a repeat test in 3 months. Elevated score recommends a follow-up transvaginal ultrasound examination of ovaries and a clinical assessment and a repeat CA125 screen. This test has been evaluated in various studies. The UK collaborative trial of ovarian cancer screening has been done to detect ovarian cancer in asymptomatic postmenopausal women between 50 and 74 years old. And in this study, they have reported a significant stage shift, that is more stage 1, 2, and 3A ovarian cancers being detected through screening than the no screening group. And also there's an average reduction in the ovarian cancer deaths of around 15% in the multimodal screening group compared to the control group. And when this study was evaluated in the UK familial ovarian cancer screening study, among high-risk women who are estimated to have more than 10% lifetime risk of developing ovarian cancer, they have found out that there's a highly significant reduction in the proportion of women being diagnosed with macroscopic metastatic disease outside the pelvis, and very low proportion of women required neoadjuvant chemotherapy, and a high proportion with zero residual disease post-surgery. And around 79% of women when diagnosed with ovarian cancer required a simple surgery, simple hysterectomy, cementectomy, and only 21% required complex surgeries. The US Preventive Services Task Force published a statement in 2018 in which they recommended against screening asymptomatic women for ovarian cancer. And screening does not seem to be a good alternative to risk-reducing surgery. The screening itself may prompt women to focus on their risk of cancer and push them towards the risk-reducing surgery if they need it. And the authors of the screening study have concluded that risk-reducing salpingectomy, oophorectomy remains a treatment of choice for women at high risk of ovarian or fallopian tube cancer. And the study published in Gynec-Oncology Journal 2018 by Naumann et al. Whether the ROCA screening algorithm is cost-effective or not, they have concluded that the ovarian cancer screening may reduce the mortality by 6-9% from ovarian cancer, but it is not cost effective.
Dr. Gayatri, 2 more minutes.
Yes, madam, it's over. Now, let's discuss the staging of ovarian cancer. The ovarian cancer updated in 2014 combines a classification of ovarian, fallopian tube, and peritoneal cancer, and it is based on findings through surgical exploration. Stage 1 is tumor confined to ovaries and fallopian tubes. 1A, it's only one ovary. 1B is confined to both ovaries and fallopian tubes with intact capsule. 1C, in 1C1 we have surgical spill, and 1C2 is when the capsule is ruptured before surgery or tumor on the ovarian or fallopian tube surface, and 1C3 the malignant cysts in ascites and peritoneal washings. This has been updated in the 2014 staging. In stage 2, the tumor gets involved with pelvic extension and peritoneal cancer, in which 2A there are implants on the uterus or fallopian tubes, and 2B, there is extension to other pelvic intraperitoneal tissues. In stage 3, there is cytologically or histologically confirmed spread to the peritoneum outside the pelvis and metastasis to retroperitoneal lymph nodes. 3A1 is a cytologically or histologically proven positive retroperitoneal lymph nodes with less than 10 mm in platelet time and tension is 3A11, and more than 10 mm is 3A12. And 3A2 is microscopic extrapelvic peritoneal involvement. This classification has been again updated in 2014 as because survival is significantly improved better in patients with retroperitoneal lymph nodes than compared to patients who have peritoneal involvement. 3B, when there is macroscopic metastasis of less than 2 cm, 3C is macroscopic metastasis of more than 2 cm, and it can also have extension of tumor to the capsule of liver and spleen. Stage 4 distant metastasis with peritoneal metastasis, it is excluded. Stage 4A is pleural effusion with positive cytology. Stage 4B is parenchymal metastasis of to the liver, spleen, and also involvement of other extra-abdominal organs and inguinal lymph nodes and lymph nodes outside the abdominal cavity. And we do the staging and we may document it. The primary site must be clearly mentioned, ovary, fallopian tube or peritoneum. And when we are not able to design it, we have to document it as undesignated. The histological type should be recorded. The retroperitoneal lymph node involvement must be confirmed histologically. And as I already told, the tumor involvement in the capsule of liver and spleen is 3C, and pan-tumor involvement, spleen involvement is stage 4B. And thank you.
Fantastic. Crisp presentation, Gayatri.
Thank you.
Mohanambal, madam, you can introduce Dr. Yeah. Kavita.
Yeah. Good afternoon, Vandana. I have an immense pleasure that I should thank our deans who have easily accepted the moment we said we are going to have a ovarian cancer update. I should thank our Maya HOD also to accept that. The Kavita Sukumar is a daughter of Dr. Kalavadi Kandasamy. I know her as a small school kid. Later, she did a UG and PG in Madras Medical College. Later, she joined as assistant surgeon. She was very much interested in. She was very much interested in oncology. She has went to Tata Memorial to have a fellowship there. After doing fellowship, again she became an IOG assistant. There she got selected for MCH oncology, gynec oncology in Raipata Medical College, Raipata Hospital attached to KMC Medical College. After finishing that, as a pediatrician, she came back to IOG. She started oncology surgical unit. Not only that surgical unit doing the surgery, she was very much interested in teaching. She has started teaching course also. She has become a director for full director fellowship in this thing. Though her mother is teaching for a PG, she is teaching for postdoctoral. So she can teach not only the surgery, the subjects also. She is a big lighting candle. She wants to light as many candles as possible. Now she wants to hear from her about the pathology as well as genetics of oncology. Over to you, Kavita, please.
Thank you so much, madam, for those nice words. At the outset, I'd like to thank the Mohanambal madam, the entire ESI team for having given me this opportunity and for such a great introduction for me. I'm really indebted to all my teachers there in IOG, and I owe what I am today to them, all of them. Now, so today the topic given to me is pathology and genetics of ovarian cancer. Now, this is a very huge topic, and I'd like to. So I'll try to just cover the salient aspects of it. Is my screen visible, madam?
Yes, Kavita.
Okay. So now, see, basically, we'll have to remember that cancer is a genetic disease. Now, for a cell from a normal cell to become a cancer cell, you need to have a series of mutation. The first, second, third. Now, slowly, when mutations keep accumulating, then later on, finally, it reaches the stage of cancer. This is true for any cancer, and that is why we find that cancer is generally a disease of the old age, because you need time for accumulation of all these genetic mutations. Now, with each of these mutations, the cell acquires certain properties. No, it becomes stronger and stronger. It knows how to evade the normal host responses, and eventually it gets all its power to become a cancer cell. So cancer is a genetic disease that we'll have to remember. Now, in 2004, what happened was they mapped the entire human genome. So what happened is, like, we had the entire set of normal genome, which is there in the human. So then they could identify the mutations which are associated with cancer. So that is how the origin of this mutation testing, dates back to this human genome project. So what they found out is, like, each cancer, they started studying the mutations present in these cancers. And they found that, not only particular genes, they found that clusters of genes were associated with certain types of cancers. So these genes, some of these genes can be present upfront, earlier on in the pathway, and some may be present later on. But they found that, say, for example, this is a PIK3 and mTOR pathway, and then you have the MEKR pathway. So you have different pathways which are present, which are mutated in different cancers. So that is how the concept of genetic pathways of cancers of were identified. Now you'll have to remember that there are two different types of mutations. Now there you have germline and somatic mutations. Now what is the difference between the two? Now germline mutations are inherited mutations. Now either the patient gets it from the parent or the gamete, the mutations happen at the level of the gametes level. So what happens is now when in the particular person who's affected, all the cells in the body will carry that particular mutation, and that is again inherited to the future progeny. So that is a germline mutation. Whereas on contrary, when you look at the somatic mutations, the gametes are normal. All the other cells in the body do not carry the mutation. It is affected only in the tumor tissue. So these are the mutations which happen in the tumor cells per se, and these are the common mutations which you see in all cancers. So, and these are not transferred to the next generation. So that is a basic difference you will have to know. So when you have an inherited mutation and that is carried on, you know, this high penetrance mutations which are carried on to family, then you call it the cancers you get following that is called a hereditary cancer. You have some, apart from this, you have some low penetrance genes, you know, some they are not typically carried on like a Mendelian inheritance. Right? Low penetrance genes can be there affected in the family, or you can have clustering of cancers in the family because of shared lifestyle or environment. You can have obesity in the family. So again, that can predispose to certain degrees of cancer. So they are called as familial cancers. And of course, the rest are what we commonly see is the sporadic cancers. Now that is about cancers in general. Now, when you, the familial cancers play a major role in especially breast and colorectal cancer. Whereas in ovarian cancer, you find that up to 25% of all cancers can be, you know, inherited. So that is the amount. Now, when you look at genetic abnormalities in ovarian cancer per se, when they studied this cancer genomic atlas, they found that this high-grade serous cancer especially is a very, very high mutated cancer, and especially you find that 96% of them will carry sporadic mutations of the p53. So that is one thing which was very striking in your ovarian cancers. Now apart from that, as I previously said, 25% of all ovarian cancers can have a germline mutation, inherited mutation, and of that the most common is the BRCA1 and 2 that we all talked about. Now what is this BRCA1 and 2? Now, BRCA genes belong to one particular family of genes, which are part of what is called as homologous recombination repair pathway. Now, this is the pathway. Now, you find that there are several proteins involved in this pathway. Now, when you're talking of this DNA damage, you know, DNA damage happens all the time. So all the time you will be exposed to some radiation, some chemical carcinogen, something, or what all of this does is goes and damages the DNA. So it can break DNA, it can do something to the DNA, mutations, everything can happen. So body has got inherent mechanisms for repair of this DNA. So this double stranded, so when you have a double stranded DNA break, now this is the very, very important repair pathway, that is a homologous recombination repair. And BRCA belongs to this family of genes. Now, when this gene is mutated, what happens is this cell loses its ability to, you know, repair this double-stranded DNA break. So what happens is these mutations keep on get perpetuating, and then later on it develops a cancer. So that's how, that is the problem with this BRCA mutations. Now, so you BRCA1 is present in chromosome 17 and BRCA2 in chromosome 13. When you're talking about this homologous repair pathway fully, you can have not only involvement of BRCA1 and 2, you can have these smaller genes, RAD51C, RAD51D, ATM, ATR, all of these also can be mutated, you know, that also can be present. So when you look at the entire profile of ovarian cancers, see, when especially when you're talking about high-grade serous cancer, the most common one is this homologous repair pathway deficiency. But when you're talking about the other types of cancers, clear cell, endometrioid, mucinous, and low-grade cancers, you can have other pathways like the KRAS, the BRAF, the mismatch repair deficiency, which is nothing but the Lynch syndrome gene. So all of these can also be mutated in ovarian cancers. You remember that you have a different pathways of mutations which can happen in ovarian cancers. So when you're, what are the histological types of epithelial ovarian cancers associated with these specific mutations? When you're talking about the HRD, that is a homologous repair deficiency, and BRCA, the most common tumor is a high-grade serous. But remember that there is a very small percentage of endometrioid, clear cell, carcinosarcoma, and low-grade serous cancers can also be involved in the BRCA pathway. The only thing which is not represented is the mucinous. So mucinous tumors are generally not associated with BRCA. Then when you're talking about the mismatch repair genes, that is the Lynch syndrome genes, the most common histopathological varieties associated with this are endometrioid, clear cell, and mucinous tumors. And the endometrioid and clear cell tumors have typically this ARID1A mutation. So these are some of these mutations which you'll probably want to remember about the epithelial ovarian cancers. Now, what are the cancers associated with BRCA? Now, predominantly we're talking in terms of breast and ovarian cancers. The breast cancers associated with BRCA are high-grade cancers, triple negative, and they have a bad prognosis. Whereas, lucky for us, the ovarian tumors associated with BRCA have got a good prognosis. They are platinum sensitive, and probably Dr. Anita will be talking about it in detail. So, but what suffice to remember that the high-grade serous cancers associated with BRCA generally have a better prognosis. And prostate cancers, again, you can have pancreatic and prostate cancers in the male members. There is probably an increased risk of serous carcinoma. We are not very sure. Serous type of uterine cancers, a little association is found. The causal relationship is not yet made out. So these are the cancers associated with BRCA. And when you're talking about lifetime risk of breast cancer is very high, around 80%. Of ovarian cancers in BRCA 1 is around 50%. The age group from which the risk increases is from 35 to 40 years in BRCA 1. In BRCA 2, the risk is a little low, 20%, and it also occurs at a little later age, 50 years in BRCA 2. So that is about the cancers associated with the now BRCA. Now, whom do you test for this BRCA? Now, do you offer testing for any particular high-risk individual or to all? Now, when you're looking at all the guidelines, NCC and SGO and ASCO and all of these guidelines, if you have a clustering of family, for example, you can see when you have breast cancer diagnosed less than 45 years, when you have a triple negative cancer less than 60 years, or you have clustering of cancers in the family. So all of this is for breast cancer. Whereas when you look at epithelial ovarian cancers, it is recommended now that any case of epithelial ovarian cancer, irrespective of its age, will have to be offered hereditary cancer testing after a thorough genetic counseling. That is because there are a lot of therapeutic implications for it. So now the current recommendation is all these women must be offered a hereditary cancer testing. So now what are the implications of testing? You do a test. Now usually a germline testing is done by a blood test and the DNA is extracted, whereas for a somatic testing you need a tumor tissue. Generally a germline testing is done first, and when you get a result, the result is reported in three ways. One, you can have the report as positive, that is it has got a pathogenic mutation. Second is it will be reported either as a likely pathogenic variant, that again you take it as a pathogenic variant. The third one is what is called as VUS, or a variant of uncertain significance, wherein you're not sure, and that is a gray area. Okay, we'll leave it for that now. So now supposing you have a pathogenic or a likely pathogenic variant, now what are the options available for the individual? Now obviously the individual is at high risk for all cancers. Supposing she's already got an ovarian cancer, she's had increased risk for a breast cancer, or vice versa. So the options are, number one, you can have an enhanced screening. Obviously, as previously mentioned by Dr. Harini, the screening is much, much more effective for a breast cancer, whereas for an ovarian cancer, the screening is much less effective. And so you need to have a very, very, short-term screening in the ROCA algorithm. You'll have to do it every 3 to 4 months, the CA-125, which is really not practical. And even then you can miss cases. So you have to remember that screening is less effective, but nevertheless, it can be offered to women after 35 years for those who refuse a risk-reducing salpingo-oophorectomy for these. But ideally, they have to be offered prophylactic surgery as means of risk-reducing salpingo-oophorectomy. You could offer them prophylactic mastectomy, but you could also screen them, because screening for breast cancer is a much better tool. Now, this RRSO is offered in a little earlier age, 35 to 40 years for BRCA 1, and can be offered a little late for BRCA 2. The other option for this individual is you can put them on pharmacoprophylaxis like oral contraceptive pills. But again, you'll have to remember there is a minor increase in risk of breast cancer with OC pill use. Again, if you have a person who's tested positive in the for one of these mutations, you also have the option of testing the other family members. The other family members can do only that particular mutant gene testing. Okay, and all these options are available to those members who again become positive. then you also have therapeutic implications. Well, no, for treatment wise, there are certain implications for BRCA testing. Number one, as I already told you, these tumors, they are much more platinum sensitive and they have a good survival compared to other epithelial, other high grade serous cancer. And second is, this is the in thing now in treatment, which are called as PARP inhibitors, the olaparib, niraparib group. Now here, these act in synergens with BRCA mutation and they really improve the progression-free survival and overall survival in these women when they are used both as first-line maintenance and also in the recurrent setting. So they are a boon right now for these patients with BRCA. So that will be covered in the medical oncology type. So you do remember that there are a lot of therapeutic implications for patients who test positive with either a germline or a somatic mutation. Okay, so next, moving on to the second half of pathology of epithelial ovarian cancer. Because of time restraints, I'm not going to the entire detail. I will just talk about the only the important salient aspect. Now, WHO, this you have something called a WHO Blue Book, which comes out every few years. And this current Blue Book for female genital tract cancers came out last month. And there are significant changes associated in endometrial, cervical, and vulvar cancer. But for ovarian cancers, there's not much of a change compared to the previous classification. Now, these are the current class, different types of epithelial ovarian cancers, which are pretty much the same. Serous, endometrioid, clear cell, mucinous, brennose, and seromucinous, which was added in the previous classification itself. And the serous will be classified into high grade and low grade. Now, this is pretty much the same. The only thing which is probably changed is each of these will have a benign borderline and a malignant variety. Now, when you the only difference they've done in this particular staging is that the seromucinous carcinomas were a separate entity in 2014 classification. Now they've grouped it under endometrioid cancers. The seromucinous carcinoma is supposed to be a variant of endometrioid carcinoma. That is one change that they brought out in the current WHO 2020. Now, about the pathogenesis of epithelial ovarian cancer, so long what was going on was that we were thinking about ovarian cancers thought to rise from the breaks in the ovarian surface epithelium because of incessant ovulation. Now, this was a landmark paper published in 2010, which really brought about a paradigm shift in the theory of origin of epithelial ovarian cancer. And now we know that most of your ovarian cancers are actually tubal in origin. So they accordingly now we have two types of epithelial ovarian cancers. Now, the type 2 ones are the more common ones, and the ovary, tube, and peritoneum, all these together, they are grouped together as extrauterine serous carcinomas because they behave in the same way. They all arise from the tube and they have this typical P53 mutations. They are these cancers which are the most common variety that you usually see, present at late stage, have a worse prognosis. That is a type 2 cancer. Now, the type 1 is a less common variety. You have what are the cancers? All these cancers, low grade serous, endometrioid, mucinous, even clear cell, all of these tumors are grouped under the type 1. And these probably arise from the ovary. And they have a stepwise progression from benign to borderline to low grade. And occasionally they can become high grade, but generally they stop at low grade. And here the pathway is KRAS BRAF. And these present at type 1 and type 2, I mean, stage 1 and stage 2, and they generally have a better progression.
Two more minutes, guys.
Just only this pathogenesis, madam. So, when you look at the serous cancers, they arise from this tube. So, from this tube, you have something called the stick cells. You first thing you have something called a P53 signature, where you have some only the mutation is there, and that becomes the stick cells. What is the serous tubal intraepithelial carcinoma, which can form a tumor within the fallopian tube, or it can form a tumor in the ovary, or it can form a tumor in the peritoneum. So from the tube, you have this type 2 cancers, whereas the type 1 is a low-grade pathway. Now, so according to this, for you to define a criteria, for most of it is called a fallopian tube cancer. If either you have a stick present or if you have any lesion there, okay, so then you call it, whatever tumor you get, if you have a lesion in the tube, then it is called a tubal cancer. Whereas only if both tubes are normal and it is separate from the ovarian mass and no stick is present in the tube, then it is called an ovarian cancer. And if both tubes and ovary have to be normal for you to call it as a primary peritoneal cancer. So that is the current criteria. Now, this I told you, endometrioid cancers, they generally arise from endometriotic implants. And when you have a uterine endometrioid and an ovarian endometrioid cancer, generally it is considered to be a metastasis from the uterine cancers. The ovary is considered to be from the uterine, but only you can call it a synchronous tumor only if it follows this criteria. Number one, both must be low grade. The uterine cancer should have very low myometal invasion, less than 50%, absence of LVSI, and there has to be no involvement of other sites. So only if it fulfills this criteria, you can call it a synchronous ovarian and endometrioid cancer. Otherwise, they are supposed to arise from the uterine cancer. And this is the last bit, madam. So when you're talking about mucinous cancer, this is a real dilemma for us because most of these mucinous cancers are metastatic basically. Primary cancer, ovarian cancers are very rare, less than around 20% only. Most of them are generally, you know, arise from GIT, pancreas, etc. And to add on to the confusion, you find that when you're looking at the histopathology of these ovarian metastases, they are very bland picture. They can just mimic benign tumors or borderline tumors. So that is going to add on to the confusion. So how do you differentiate between primary and metastatic mucinous tumors? Generally, primary tumors are large, unilateral, and they have this particular expansive pattern of invasion. When you have an associated borderline tumors, endometriosis or a teratoma, it favors a primary. And then you have a wide array of immunohistochemical stains from which you can differentiate a primary from, you know, metastatic. So this is one example wherein, see, look at this picture, very, very, you know, just one septum is here, otherwise very bland looking ovarian mass. So we had a call over, and when they opened up for this, they found that this kind of pseudomyxoma present in the UV fold, and on seeing that there was an appendicular primary. This actually was an appendicular primary with a metastasis to the mucinous metastasis to the ovary. So remember that this is a very real picture that you can encounter in day-to-day life. So to conclude, you have to remember that epithelial ovarian cancer is a very highly mutated cancer, and you have to offer currently genetic testing to all cases of epithelial ovarian cancer after genetic counseling, because you have options of prevention and treatment available. But when you're talking about pathology, you find that now majority of cancers which you see in the ovaries are basically from extra ovarian organs, especially the tube and ovary. You know, it turns out that it is only the soil. And so primary tumors actually originating from ovary are most probably only germ cell and stromal tumors like your testicular counterparts. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, Koida. You made a big chapter in the nutshell. Yes, crystal clear. Thank you very much.
Yes, madam. Now, I invite Dr. Anita to talk on pre-treatment assessment in cancer clinic. Anita has done did her UG in Mysore and PG from JIPMA. She is the assistant professor in ESI, and she had lab and infertility training with Dr. Kurian. Back to Dr. Anita.
Anita, ma'am, are you able to hear us, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay.
Not able to see her in the screen.
Anita ma'am, which ID are you logged on from? Dr. Harini, can you confirm if yes, Anita ma'am is there over there? Okay.
Anita is there?
Yes, she's there trying. It's not opening. Something is. She kept ready to celebrate the winter.
Ma'am, just confirming. Is she able to unmute her mic?
Thank you. Sorry for the inconvenience. Today I'm going to see
Ma'am, your voice is not clear. There's a lot of echo. Can I request you to? Ma'am, your slide is also not visible, ma'am. And ma'am, can I request you to connect to your phone?
Yes, Anita, we can see the screen.
I'm going to speak about diagnostic and preoperative workup of ovarian cancer.
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Go to the next slide.
The main goal of diagnostic evaluation is to differentiate benign and malignant ovarian pathology. The patient detected with suspicious or malignant ovarian tumor should be referred to a gynecologic oncologist for optimal management. And the patient has the high risk factors by family history, like family history of cancer, should be referred to a genetic counseling center.
Nachi.
Can you hear me?
No slide.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you, but no slides, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, we can see the slides now.
Can you hear me, madam?
Yes, slide is seen. You are audible. Proceed.
Not audible, ma'am. It's audible.
Ma'am, you're audible.
Recent NCCN guidelines on pre-op workup includes abdominal pelvic examination, evaluating the nutritional status, obtaining the family history and blood investigation like saturated blood count, biochemistry profile and liver function test, imaging tests like ultrasonography, abdominal pelvic CT, MRI, TAN25 and other tumor markers, chest CT or chest X-ray as clinically indicated, GA evaluation is included. And the patient should be referred to gynecological oncologist for clinically suspicious lesions. The clinical examination findings includes thorough general physical examination, breast examination, abdominal pelvic and rectal examination. According to FIGO cancer report in 2018, the features concerning for malignancy include solid fixed irregular markers, bilaterality of the markers, ascites, and the cul de sac nodularity. The routine pap smear test can detect 5% of the genital malignancies. Among them, 5% are ovarian cancer and 1% are the tubal cancer. CVS is the most recommended and it is the most commonly used imaging modality for evaluation of the adnexal masses. Advantages being the it is widespread availability, good patient tolerability, and relatively less inexpensive than the other imaging modalities, and the diagnostic performance is similar to the other imaging modalities. The main limitation being the lack of specificity and the low positive predictive value. Doppler ultrasonography improves the specificity. However, the resistance indexes, there is a considerable overlap between the benign and the malignant masses. The sonographic characteristics that is associated with the ovarian cancer are the irregular solid ovarian tumors and ascites, at least 4 papillary projections, irregular multilocular polygon tumor with a diameter of more than 10 cm and very strong intratumoral blood flow. So a consensus paper from the Society of Radiologists in Ultrasonography indicated that transvaginal ultrasonography supplemented with the transabdominal ultrasound is the best technique for imaging and characterization of the pelvic mass. So many predictive models have been updated till now, most common being the IOTA model. Although till now there is a debate continues regarding the superiority as well as generalizability of one strategy over the another. The IOTA group, it is a multi-collaborative project founded by the Timmerman et al. In 1992.
Anita, not audible.
Ma'am, you're not audible.
Just the next.
No, ma'am, we cannot hear you.
Unmute.
Ma'am, she's unmuted. There is some issue at. Ma'am, can I request you to check the audio jack once? We're not able to hear you clearly. Ma'am, the voice is very muffled. Still no, ma'am. That voice is not clear, ma'am. Ma'am, the voice is very. It's not clear, ma'am. That's the issue. No, ma'am, it's muffled. Ma'am, for a minute, that was much better. The sound.
In prediction of benign and malignant tumors, benign features suggestive of benign malignancies are unilocular tumors and presence of solid components where the largest solid component is less than 7 mm, presence of acoustic shadows, smooth multilocular tumor with the largest diameter less than 10 cm, and there is no blood flow. And the malignant features suggestive of malignant tumors are the M1 rule suggests irregular solid tumor, presence of M2 suggests presence of ascites, M3 at least four papillary structure, at least four papillary structure should be present, and M4 irregular multilocular solid tumor with the largest diameter more than 10 cm, M5 suggests very strong blood flow. If one or more M rules are present, in the absence of the B rule, the mass is classified as malignant. If one or more B rules are apply in the absence of the M rule, the mass is classified as benign. If both M and B rules are present, it is classified as inconclusive, and the patient should be referred to the expert ultrasonographist. CT scan is the recommended imaging modality for staging of the ovarian cancer. It gives clinical relevant information regarding the size of the tumor, primary tumor, and location of the peritoneal implants, hepatic metastasis, and obstetric uropathy. And patients with large ascites and patient with large ascites, the detection rate is very high. However, CT has a limited role in detecting the small peritoneal metastasis. MRI has a staging accuracy similar to the conventional helical CT, and it has a excellent tissue differentiation and superior to soft tissue, soft tissue contrast resolution and the invasion of the pelvic organs. And it is a better characterization of the intermittent lesion seen on the CT and ultrasonography, and it is superior to CT in predicting the resectability and recurrence. The value of PET scan is still being evaluated, and it is a limited role in characterization of the ovarian mass, but helpful in staging and detection of the recurrent cancers. But it is having a limited spatial resolution role in detection of the deposits. It is less than 1 centimeter of mass. NICE guidelines suggest no specific imaging modality has a proved superior to the others, although MRI tends to be favored to be determine the origin of the pelvic mass, like from the uterine, ovarian, or the bowel cancers. If the findings on the ultrasonography cannot clearly characterize the origin of the adnexal mass, the further imaging should be the patient should be referred to a consultant radiologist for the further imaging. Now coming to the tumor markers are not diagnostic but can help to characterize the ovarian mass. CA125 have a varied sensitivity and specificity among premenopausal and the postmenopausal women, and it is not useful when used alone, but is useful when used serially and incorporated in the biomarker panels. And it is the positive predictive value is about 98% in postmenopausal women and 49% in premenopausal women. HE2 is the human epidermis antigen, and it is elevated in the serous and endometrioid cancer, and it is incorporated in the risk of malignance algorithm and the OVERA. Currently, there is no serum biomarker that is highly sensitive and specific for the diagnosis of epithelial ovarian cancer. Therefore, there is an increasing in the use of biomarker panels and the detection for clinical correlation and the morphology. These are the newer biomarkers which has been validated by FDA. OVA1 is nothing but the multivariate index, and the OVERA is the second generation multivariate index, and ROMA, risk of ovarian malignancy algorithm.
2 more minutes, Anita.
And risk of malignancy algorithm includes CA125 and HE2 tumor marker. Now coming to the risk malignancy index, it is originally developed in 1990, and it includes ultrasound markers, menopausal status, and CA125, and it is suggested by the NICE guidelines. And it incorporates three features, as I said, ultrasonography feature, menopausal status, and CA125. Ultrasonography features, 1 point for each of the following: multilocular cysts, solid areas, metastasis, ascites, and bilateral masses. 0 point is given for there is no ultrasound score, and 1 point is given for patient diagnosed with one score, and three ultrasound score is given for the patient diagnosed with two or three ultrasonic features. And menopausal state, one score is given if they are pre-menopausal, three score is given if they are post-menopausal. CA125 is measured in international unit per ml. And the main disadvantage is falsely elevated if the CA125 is also elevated. Overall false sensitivity is 78% and specificity is 87%. These are the other types of RNA markers but studies have shown all are equally effective in predicting the malignancies. The FDA has approved the use of these clinical markers. However, NCCN guidelines still not doesn't recommend the use of these markers for routine practice. These are the other tumor markers used: CA125-2, CEA, CA19.9. Now coming to the tissue diagnosis, it is avoided in the presumably early stage disease to prevent the rupturing of the cyst and spillage of the malignant cells into the peritoneal cavity. However, patients with the advanced disease in poor clinical status who are not surgical candidates, image guided biopsy is indicated, and laparoscopic biopsy is performed if the image guided biopsy is not able to produce adequate sample. Cytological assessment by diagnostic paracentesis is in patient with gross ascites without any obvious mass is indicated. Now coming to the non-epithelial ovarian carcinoma, although there are similarity in presentation, evaluation, and management of these patients, the tumors have
time up. Please cut short your slides.
Special approach: non-epithelial malignancies accounts for 10% of the ovarian cancer, most common being the germ cell tumors. And workup from germ cell tumors starts with the clinical features and examination and use of imaging modalities and tumor markers. And adnexal mass, the patient diagnosed with adnexal mass more than 2 centimeters in the premenarchal women and more than 8 centimeters in the premenopausal patients requires surgical exploration. And karyotyping is must, especially in dysgerminoma, because it is associated with the dysgenetic gonads. And the patient also fertility preservation options also should be considered. Dysgerminoma constitute about 80 to 90% cases of the germ cell tumors, and then this is the only tumor which is having 10 to 15% of bilateral.
Anita, can you summarize?
It is diagnosed by, this is the symptoms criteria in the order of frequency suggested by Berek et al. Acute abdominal pain, chronic abdominal pain, asymptomatic abdominal mass, abnormal vaginal bleeding, and abdominal distension. The specific tumor marker being PLAP and the LDH. Immature teratoma is the second most common germ cell malignancy, most commonly found in less than 20 years of age, and they can present as mixed germ cell tumors, the specific tumor marker being the alpha beta protein. Endodermal sinus tumor or nothing but the yolk sac carcinoma are third most frequent germ cell tumors, most commonly occurring between 16 to 18 years. It is most commonly associated with dysgerminoma. It is 100% biopsy of the opposite ovary is contraindicated. It secretes alpha fetal protein and alpha 1 antitrypsin. Embryon. It is extremely rare tumor. Embryonal carcinoma is an extremely rare tumor, and the age of presentation is from 4 to 28 years. They present with the precocious puberty. And sex tremor tumors, they can present in the juvenile and adult type, and they will present with the precocious puberty. In the postmenopausal group, they will present with the postmenopausal bleeding. They secrete inhibin B and AMH level, AMH hormones. Sertoli-leading tumors presents in the third and the fourth decades of the life. They typically secrete androgens. These are the tumors specific for the germ cell and the sex cord stromal tumors. Sarcoma of the ear is the rarest tumor, and it is a malignant mixed mesodermal tumor, and accurate diagnosis and differentiation from the other tumor is necessary. The metastatic tumors constitute about 5 to 6% of the ovarian tumors. Tubal carcinoma accounts for 13% of the cases. Cervical carcinoma in less than 1% of the cases. Adenocarcinoma of the endometrium in 5% of the cases. So, importance of synchronous tumors also should be stressed. Crookengun tumor accounts for 2% of the ovarian cancers. Primary tumor is located in the stomach. The POP evaluation includes barium enema and colonoscopy, upper GI gastroscopy, bilateral diagnostic mammography, and endometrial biopsy and endocervical curettage. And according to NICE guidelines, the evaluation of the ovarian mass in a premenopausal age group, if they are diagnosed with RMI more than 200 with the CT scan, which is suggestive of malignancy, the patient should be referred to gyneco-oncologist.
Thank you, sir.
And RMA less than 200 and the diameter more than 7 cm mass should be subjected to surgical management. Postmenopausal women with a complex ovarian mass more than 5 cm and with RMA less than 200 requires surgery, and less than 1 cm mass and less than 5 cm mass requires follow-up. The conclusion, there is no effective screening strategy for detection of the ovarian cancer. TVS and ultrasonography is recommended for pre-op evaluation. CT MRI is useful for the staging of the tumor. The ultrasound predictive models like IOTA, the use of IOTA debate continues still regarding the superiority as well as generalizability. Tumor markers are not diagnostic but help to characterize the ovarian mass when combined with the clinical and morphological indices. And importance of fertility preservation should be emphasized in the reproductive age group. Thank you.
Thank you, Anita. Madam, you can introduce Dr. Karthikeyan. Mohanambal, madam.
Ma'am, your mic has been muted. Can you? Yes, thank you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, madam. Introduce Dr. Karthikeyan, madam.
Dr. Karthikeyan is attached to our ASI Medical College. Actually, he has undergraduation at Madurai Medical College. He did his MRCS in Edinburgh. He got the MCH from Gujarat Cancer Research Institute. And he has got a gold medalist from BJ Medical College. He is a surgeon. He has got a dancing finger. He starts the head to foot where he can do surgery. He is not only an oncology surgeon, very much caring for the patient. He has done a lot of surgery after coming here for a short period. We used to admire his surgery. After his arrival, we have got a strong backbone. We are able to take up all the oncology cases. He is of kind help to us. After Dr. Karthikeyan has joined, our oncology surgery is going up and up. Actually, he is a father to our MCA Medical College. Over to you, sir. Please carry on, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Yes. Can I have my slides? Today, good afternoon, everyone. I am going to speak about the surgical management of the ovarian malignancies. So, next slide. So, we all know that the median age is around 60 to 64 years, but the mortality of the ovarian malignancies is increasing, mainly for the women who are older than 65 years age. Next slide. So, how we are going to surgically manage these patients? It depends upon the stage of the tumor. It is divided into early stage and late stage. Early stage, it is FIGO 1. Late stage, FIGO 2 to 4. First, I will say what we have to do in a early stage, FIGO 1. Next slide. Next. So these are some pictures of the early ovarian tumors of 1A. Next. This is the second malignancy. It's a 1A. Next. Early stages, the cure rate is very high, but unfortunately, only 10 to 15% of the epithelial malignancies are diagnosed in the early stage disease. So the surgery, what we are going to do in the early stage ovarian malignancy is primary cytoreduction. What is primary cytoreduction? I will explain in the next slides. Next. So why surgical staging is important? It is a very tumor, small tumor in the one ovary and it is not spread to anywhere, you are saying it is a stage 1A, then why you have to do a surgical staging? Because if we have done a full surgical staging in figure 1A or 1B grade 1 and 2 malignancies, adjuvant chemotherapy is not required. So this is the most important thing. If we have done anything less than the surgical staging in figure 1A and 1B, the patient will undergo chemotherapy. So the chemotherapy, maybe the medical oncologist will be angry with me, but to prevent chemotherapy, figure 1A and 1B, we have to go for a complete surgical staging. Next. So what are the things to be done in a surgery? It's always a midline incision, vertical midline incision, depending upon the size of the ovary, you extend the incision. And you must have a frozen section when you are operating an ovary to see the doubtful lesions. Whenever you are having doubtful, you must send it for a frozen section. Sometimes laparoscopy is useful in early stages. Without rupturing the ovary, you can remove it. Next. So in CA ovary, the most important is the operative report. What are the things to be mentioned in an operative report? So before debulking, so when you open the abdomen, before you are going for a surgery, you must write about the extent of the disease in three spaces, in the pelvis, mid abdomen, and upper abdomen. Pelvis is up to the pelvic brim. Below the pelvic brim, what are the diseases there? And mid abdomen is up to the lower border of the costal cartilages and upper abdomen. And the thing after the surgery, what are the amount of residual tissue that is left after debulking? Whether you have done a complete debulking in these three places, pelvis, mid abdomen, or upper abdomen, or incomplete. If incomplete, you have to mention the size of the major lesion, whether it is 2 centimeters, 5 centimeters, and the number of lesions. If you are not able to see the size, you have to mention it is a miliary, small lesions or miliary. So these are the things to be done in an operative report. Next. So after a midline incision, what are the things to be done in an early stage disease? If there is an ascitic fluid, you will take it for cytology. If there is no ascitic fluid, you have to do a peritoneal lavage and take the peritoneal fluid for cytology. All suspicious peritoneal surfaces to be biopsied. Everywhere, wherever you see a nodularity, induration, everything, it should be biopsied. In the absence of suspicious areas, random biopsies should be taken from the pelvic peritoneum, both the paracolic gutters and diaphragm. If the incision is higher, you can go up to the diaphragm or you can scrap it from the diaphragm, the cells, and you can take it for a cytology. Then we have to go for a hysterectomy and a bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. Then next, omentectomy should be done. If there is no gross disease in the omentum, infracolic omentectomy is enough. If the omentum shows, or if you are doubtful, there is the omentum is not very much normal, you have to go for a supracolic omentectomy. Then bilateral pelvic lymph node dissection should be done. So the vessels you have to see is common iliac, external iliac, and the internal iliac. So common iliac, over the common iliac, and anterolateral to the common iliac, mostly up to the genital branch of genitofemoral nerve, and overlying and medial to the external iliac vessels, overlying and medial to the hypogastric vessels. Obturator fossa should be done minimum anterior to the obturator nerve. These are all the boundaries for a pelvic lymph node dissection. So there will be ureter, always lateral to the ureter and medial to the genitofemoral nerve. Lowermost border will be the inguinal ligament and anterior to the obturator nerve. These are all the boundaries for a pelvic lymph node dissection. Whatever the fat fascia, whatever this thing is there, we have to do a bilateral pelvic lymph node dissection. Next, parietic down dissection should be done, and it should be over the aorta and IVC, and it is at least up to the inferior mesenteric artery. And if full parietic node dissection is done, it is preferably up to the renal vessels. Next. So these are all the some ovarian malignancies, early stage malignancies with you can see the solid components. Next. So these are all the solid components present in the ovary. Next. So midline incision is done and the ovary is removed. No ascites. Cytology was given, peritoneal lavage. Next. Next. So the ovary tumor with the thing. So figure one, we know what are the things to be done. It is called primary cytoreduction, and the thing is BST hysterectomy with the bilateral solfingo oophorectomy plus omentectomy plus bilateral pelvic lymph node and the para-aortic. These are the things to be done in a primary cytoreduction. The late stages, figure 2 to 4, it is divided into operable and the inoperable, where optimal cytoreduction is not possible. Next. So in the late stage, what is that we are saying optimal cytoreduction? So that size, centimeters size, the centimeters of the optimal cytoreduction is coming down. Previously it was 2 centimeters, then it was 1 centimeter. But now the modern school of thought mandates that goal of cytoreductive surgery is to leave behind no gross residual tissue. That is R0 resection is the optimal cytoreduction in a CA ovary. Next. So this is primary cytoreduction. What are the things to be done? First is ascites is there. You have to remove the ascites and send for cytology, peritoneal lavage, omentum, I have explained. The nodes, whenever there is a suspicious or enlarged nodes, you have to remove it. Dissection of clinical nodes is not required. The tumor nodules less than 2 centimeters outside the pelvis, if you notice that, you know, less than 2 centimeters, it is coming in stage 3, should undergo bilateral pelvic and para-aortic nodes. If there is no nodules outside the pelvis, only the suspicious or enlarged nodes is enough. Next. With that, these are all the things that are included: bowel dissection, appendicectomy, stripping of the diaphragm and other peritoneum, splenectomy, partial cystectomy, partial hepatectomy, partial gastrectomy, cholecystectomy, and a distal pancreatectomy. Whenever you are able to do any all these procedures with the R0 complete resection, you have to do a R0 complete resection, removing this. These are things for the primary cytoreduction. Next. So when you will be giving a neoadjuvant chemotherapy, the thing is, when you are not able to do a R0 resection, the thing is, when the patient is not surgically fit and there is an undesectable abdominal disease or extra abdominal metastasis, maybe in lung or mediastinum, massive ascites, here you cannot give a R0 complete resection. In this patients, there is a role of, there is 100% a role of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Next. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy, we will be giving 3 or 4 cycles and we will assess it. If the patient we are seeing is able, we are able to give a R0 complete resection, we will do a interval debulking surgery after 4 weeks to allow the bone marrow recovery. And 3 weeks after the surgery, patient can resume the chemotherapy again, depending upon the final pathology report. So after 3 or 4 cycles, we will assess. And if it is operable, we will go for an interval debulking after 4 weeks of the last cycle of chemotherapy. Next. So what are the things to be removed in an interval cytoreduction? Primary cytoreduction, we have seen interval cytoreduction. The same as the primary cytoreduction, but something different is same hysterectomy, bilateral solfingo oophorectomy, the omentum to be removed, the peritoneum. Wherever the disease is there, you can remove the peritoneum. Any suspicious or enlarged nodes should be removed. The metastatic nodes that are initial in the diagnosis, but they have regressed in the now the recent scan, should be removed. The metastatic nodes that are present in the early initial diagnosis should be removed. And all other procedures like hepatectomy, partial gastrectomy, partial cystectomy, appendectomy, distal pancreatectomy should be done. So these are the things to be done in a interval cytoreduction. Interval cytoreduction is after a neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Next. And another role is secondary cytoreduction. What is secondary cytoreduction? So primary cytoreduction is first surgery. Interval cytoreduction is after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Secondary cytoreduction is surgery is primary cytoreduction is done. After that, adjuvant chemotherapy is given. And after that, there is a disease. When the disease is present more than 12 months after the primary surgery, or we have a very small volume disease or isolated small recurrent disease, we can go ahead and operate these patients. This is called secondary cytoreduction. Tertiary cytoreduction is also there. So for thing, secondary cytoreduction is having a small volume or isolated more than 12 months after the first surgery. You have to go for a surgery. That is secondary cytoreduction. Next, fertility preserving. Whenever germ cell tumor is there, or whenever the patient's fertility has to be preserved, the single ovary is there, epithelial ovarian malignancy is also, we can go for a unilateral solfingo oophorectomy. Not oophorectomy, it is always solfingo oophorectomy. It's because it's been explained in the pathogenesis. Always you go for a unilateral solfingo oophorectomy or bilateral solfingo oophorectomy. Then mucinous neoplasms, we'll be doing all the other surgeries. The normal appendix need not to be removed. If the appendix is inflamed or there is a doubtful about the origin, we can go for appendicectomy. Otherwise, normal appendix need not to be removed in a mucinous neoplasm. Next. So this is the unilateral disease and a unilateral solfingo oophorectomy is done. Next. This is a unilateral solfingo oophorectomy is done. Next. Next. So then there comes the advanced treatments. It is intraperitoneal chemotherapy and a HIPEC. Intraperitoneal chemotherapy. Why we are giving a chemotherapy in the peritoneum? Because of the prolonged...
2 minutes
more, sir.
Madam? 2 minutes more, sir.
Okay, ma'am. It is because of the prolonged confinement of the disease within the peritoneal cavity. And the steep dose response relationship, we are giving a intraperitoneal chemotherapy. And the advantage is it goes to the blood is very low and the side effects are very low. Next. So this port is placed in the abdomen with a tube. Next. This is placed in the abdomen. Next. It is inside the peritoneal cavity and the tumor sidal chemotherapy drug is used with this port. But with the progression free survival rate and overall survival rate are coming near normal. Near normal means it is equal to the IV chemotherapy. So mostly it is very less useful. Next. For that we are using HIPEC. What is HIPEC? It is hypothermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy. So when you are having a patient who has responded to the neoadjuvant chemotherapy and you have cleared the disease R0, you can use the HIPEC. Next. This is the machine. The HIPEC fluid will be there. Chemotherapy will be added. It will go to the peritoneal cavity. It will come again and it will heat. The temperature will be around 41 to 42 degrees. So it kills the cancer cells. Next. So advantages, you can have a high dose of chemotherapy. It is more effective to the cancer cells that are too small to be seen. It reduces the side effects because of its plasma barrier and its improved survival benefit is proven. Next. So high concentration chemotherapy is given. Blood peritoneal barrier is there, less side effects. Next. The heat itself is a direct toxic and it improves the chemotherapy penetration. And the heat, it reduces the resistance of the drug. So HIPEC is very useful. Next. So the criteria, only some relative contraindications are there, the patient's age and the physical condition. Next. The absolute contraindications are any extra-abdominal disease, very extensive intra-abdominal disease that cannot be removed, and cancer of unknown primary. Next. So there are two scores, cytoreduction scores, and PCA. Next. Peritoneal cancer index. So depending upon this, we will be giving the hyper. Next. Next. So this is the machines of HIPEC that's used here. Next. 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 So there are four methods of HIPEC. One is the open method, where it is the drug is infused inside and it is stirred with the hand or anything so that it goes in all the cavities. Next. This is the closed method. The abdomen is closed and with the help of the drains, the fluid is going inside and the going is coming outside. This is the closed method. Next. What nowadays we are using is a semi-open method. That is both the open and the closed method combined. We are using a retractor and we are covering it with the thing and it is useful, have both advantages of open and the closed thing. Or otherwise we can use a laparoscopic HIPEC in which we can close it and use a laparoscopic to stir the fluid. So this is laparoscopic HIPEC, enhanced HIPEC. So four types, open, closed, what we are commonly using semi and laparoscopically enhanced HIPEC. Next. Next. So these are all the patients we have done a peritonectomy. So the patient having peritoneal disease. Next. So this is the peritonectomy. The peritoneum is removed with the disease. Next. So this is how the peritoneum is done. You can see the parietal layer and the whole peritoneum is removed from the abdominal wall. Next. So all the peritoneum, lateral wall peritoneum, pelvic peritoneum, supradiaphragmatic, the omentum, everything is removed. Next. So where R0 resection is not possible, we are not doing peritonectomy. The photos I will show you. Next. So when the disease is there all over the mesentery of the small bowel like this, we cannot do a peritonectomy or HIPEC. We will do a simple chemotherapy or we can go ahead with the further chemotherapy. Next. So it is there in the stomach, whole stomach is studded with the disease. So we cannot go ahead. We can, if it is partial gastrectomy, we can do. Total gastrectomy is we are not at all doing. Next. So it is there in the small bowel mesentery. So this patient also will not go for a peritonectomy and a HIPEC. Next. So the survival with the surgeries and chemotherapies, it is improving. First, stage one, the survival is around more than 90. It is 95. Stage two, the 5-year survival is 70s. And we are concentrating more on the stage three and stage four. The 5-year survival is 27. But with the advantages of HIPEC, the survival is becoming more and more. Maybe another time we are presenting, the FIGO stage three and four survival will be around 50%. Thank you. Next slide. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Very crystal clear pictures. So the pictures are very nice, as if you are seeing the surgery in person. Thank you very much for your kind presentation.
Thank you.
Yes, next speaker is Dr. Anita Ramesh. She will speak on the role of chemotherapy. She is the HOD of Medical Oncology ESI, and she has been in Savita and PGI, and she is a consultant in Apollo and Kaveri Hospital. She has received many international scholarships and awards from Germany and Dubai. And she is a realistic award for women in 2018 and golden women in 2020. And she is the founder, CEO and management trustee, Freedom from Cancer Research and Relief Foundation. Back to Dr. Anita.
Yes, thank you very much. And a good evening to everybody. I've shared my slides. Can you put my slides on? I've already shared them. Okay, yes, thanks. I was listening to all these speakers. I think everybody spoke excellently well. And it's just very much customized what's the RPG's needs at this point of time. So now let's move on to...
Ma'am, you'll have to reshare your slides, ma'am.
I have to reshare?
Yeah, what? Yes, ma'am.
Hmm. 1 minute.
Yes.
Okay. Just 1 minute then. Okay. Okay, it's fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so as we move on, and today what we are going to see, we are restrict our discussion only to the use of the PARP inhibitors in the management of ovarian cancer. And we heard our pathology talk telling us about that molecular profiling is needed. And we have also gone through the ovarian cancer introduction. What are the unmet needs? We'll just look into what the PARP inhibitors is going to give us at this point of me, and I will summarize in a short while and with a short talk as we are running behind time. So let's look into advanced ovarian cancer. The stage 3 and the 4 are what is known as advanced 3, is basically the locoregional disease with ascites and multiple abdominal mets. And once the disease goes outside the abdomen, it's a stage 4. And if you see the total story of how this cancer goes on, and initially with the surgery and chemotherapy, as what we heard, the story of excellent surgery is done, R0, and we give that adjuvant chemotherapy, and you might get a progression-free survival around 12 months. But then those locally advanced tumors do start coming back. The patient becomes symptomatic. There is an abdominal distension. He has breathing difficulty, pain. And that's the time when we really, once you look into do a scan and you see there's a recurrence of the mass ascites. And if the time period between the last treatment and the patient's coming back is more than 12 months, we call it a platinum sensitive relapse. Means things are a little better. Yes, we have the platinum drug with us. Platinum is basically cisplatin and carboplatin. But if the time is short and the patient just relapses within a matter of 6 months, that is what is called the platinum resistant relapses. And platinum resistant relapse are the sad story, and the outlook is not very good. Options are limited, but still we do have options to offer them. Now, if you see the flowchart of with the diagnosis and treatment, and we heard that stage 1, they are really curable tumors, and the surgical details you know, with the total abdominal hysterectomy, bilateral sulfingo, oophorectomy, do a peritoneal dissection, sampling, remove all the nodes. If it is stage 1 A and B, we just observe, we do not give any chemotherapy. Sometimes we do give, if we think high-risk features, follow-up is not there. But definitely for 1C, when the surface of the tumor is ruptured, chemotherapy, platinum-based is the, and usually Taxols and platinum is the drug of choice. Once in 3 weeks, 6 to 8 cycles, maximum is the 6 cycles that we go ahead. Now, what happens to the stage 2 and 4? Like our surgeon feels he's not able to operate it. He has already mentioned that the role of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Yes, the drugs are the same, taxanes and platinum, 3 to 4 cycles, review with the surgeon. If the surgeon feels he's comfortable, we go ahead with the cytoreductive surgery. And cytoreductive, what we are looking as on today is the R0 resection. There is no residue at the end of surgery. And after that, we give another adjuvant chemotherapy for another 2 to 3 cycles. To total chemo cycles is 6 to 8 with surgery complete. A very important point I just want to mention for the post-graduation. Remember, this is one of the cancers, the epithelial ovarian tumor, where there is no role of radiation. So never say that radiotherapy is needed. Germ cell tumor, yes, but not the epithelial ovarian tumors. Now, in the adjuvant setting, once we finish, we keep the patients on follow-up and see when usually stage one is 90% survival, stage 2 is almost 70, stage 3 it comes down around 60, and to see whether they relapse or not. But in a scenario where somebody has not been, the surgeon has not been able to give an R0 resection, he was not able to take it out, and was a lot of tumor which was left behind. And I think that's quite common in many places. We do live back because the tumor may not be resectable. And that's what R1, R2 is, that residual disease. And those are the patients who might need maintenance, or not might mean, will need a maintenance therapy, where the bevacizumab is a drug, and plus or minus PARP inhibitors depending upon the molecular status. So these are the unmet medical needs for and we do need drugs for this patient, and worst prognosis of all the ovarian malignancies is of all the gynecological malignancies, if you want to say, is the epithelial ovarian tumor. So 5-year survival, if you take across all stages, is 46, and it comes down low, less than 20% if the stage is a metastatic one. So, and the stage 3 and 4, that's 3 particularly, maximum 2 to 3 years, and within that 40 to 50% the tumor keeps coming back, and in stage 4 also. So that's not a, that's a very sad story, and we have patients coming to the OPD and they will be really miserable. So what do we need to do for them? How can we improve their survival? How can we improve their chance of living again? So progression-free survival and an important prognostic factor, the more longer the platinum-free interval, longer is the survival. So as once you stop treatment, how long the patient, the disease does not come back, it what matters. The longer is the relapse-free or progression-free interval, higher is the chance of that patient to be subjected to the second line to give another therapy. So, and that's how the curve goes. And so what we are looking for, a longer progression-free survival. Now let's see. Now initially we never had drugs. Couple of years back, bevacizumab is an anti-angiogenic agent which has come into the picture. Yes, we are using in our ASI hospital, the drug is available. Also biomarkers for PARP sensitivity, several biomarkers are there to identify the PARP sensitivity, particularly the BRCA mutation. And I'm sure all the students know about the Angelina Jolie effect. That is, the Angelina Jolie was not a patient, but when she did her genetic markers, as her multiple family members were suffering from breast and ovarian cancer, it's a disease of the breast and the ovary, these mutations are present. These mutations are also present in other cancers, but not for purview of discussion today. But yes, this BRCA2 particularly predisposes to high-grade serous carcinoma of the ovary. And so if you are harboring this mutation, it is, yeah, there's a chance of you and a high risk of you to get the ovarian cancer or the breast cancer as well. There is also another biomarker called the HRD, homologous recombination deficiency, and that is like BRCA needs to be detected. And if it is there, we have the drug with the PARP inhibitors. So another clinical parameters is how sensitive the patient is to platinum, the number of times you have failed the therapy, and those with high grade serous histology. So if you see that, what's the rationale? Approximately half of these high grade serous ovarian cancers does harbor this BRCA mutation as well as the HR deficient mutation. And that's a big chunk of this patient which offers. Initially, we never had drugs. But yes, in our setting, now it is available, but yet to be approved in ESI. It's not there in the formulary, this drug, but it is available in CGHS, ECHS, and other private sectors. Yes, that the drug is olaparib. So we have something to offer to our patient in a recurrent setting that's brought into the FDA approval by Study 19 and SOLO. And these are the two randomized trials which looked into, it's a phase 3 randomized double-blinded study, which SOLO looked into. If you fail 2 lines of platinum and you have a BRCA mutation, and if I give the olaparib 300 milligram twice daily, and I look into your progression-free survival, and I want to see your overall survival as well. Similarly, Study 19 also looked into, but they did not select by BRCA mutation. They did the whole set of HRD mutations, and the dose was 400, and they also had the same final parameters. And so that was the study looking into overall response, response rate, duration of overall survival, progression-free survival response. And if you see the two curves, the brown curve, the brown purple color is the olaparib, and the other one is the placebo. And there's a difference of approximately a little more than 4 months between the two, and the statistical significance is there. And final overall survival also favors olaparib, though the curve did not separate too much and the p-value was not significant, but there's an intent to improvement in survival. And so this leaves us with a little good news. Yes, we have something to offer, which we never had at an earlier days to do. And that's the SOLO study, which looked into high-grade serous, endometrial, failed two lines. And once you document the BRCA mutation and you keep the olaparib and looked into secondary endpoints, overall survival in these patients. And how you see the two curves are separating, with the maroon one is 19.1 month. That's the olaparib 300 milligram BD compared to the placebo. And so this results confirms the findings from study 19 and provides an evidence that olaparib in a platinum sensitive high grade serous tumor in a relapsed setting, yes, it does have an improvement of overall survival and progression free survival, with an intent to improve in the overall survival. And if you see the p value, it's quite significant. It's less than 0.005. So that gives you is a statistical evidence saying that there is definite superiority of this. They also looked into the progression-free survival too, which has been improvement in an interim analysis, and it is there is definitely an improved incidence with, again, a statistically significant p-value. So it comes with a tablet. The adverse events are mostly not much. It's an oral tablet at home, mostly mild to moderate. 11% of the patients, that means a very small section discontinued because of the adverse side effects. Just minimum side effects of nausea, vomiting, little fatigue, and anemia. The incidence of grade 3 was very minimum, and the majority was subsided, was 1 to 3, and it's a manageable complication. And only around 10% discontinued due to major side effect. One of the important potential risk factors are the MDS and AML. You might get it, are the primary malignancies. But if you see the chart, the incidence is 1.5%, and in SOLO 2 is 3%, almost less than 2 to 3%. And in a pooled data, it's just approximately 1 to 2%. And that's quite negligible. And many drugs in oncology do have side effects, which runs in very less than a 5%. But that may not be that. If you weigh the risks and the benefits, the benefit is much higher than this 2% of having a second malignancy. And moreover, she has to live to get the second malignancy. So these incidents are quite low, and the consistent with the expected background, it is being communicated that may not be a major factor. So when SOLO 2 and study 19 concluded, the benefit was 70% of risk reduction of disease progression with the olaparib compared to the placebo. It was consistent both with the BRCA mutation and the homologous deficient mutations as well. Secondary endpoints were met. It's well tolerated. The grade 3 acute adverse toxicities were reasonably less, and it's a safe profile of the drug was demonstrated. And so olaparib, you can give olaparib irrespective of the BRCA status, those who have failed multiple line, and demonstrate the olaparib and its patients a prolonged chemo-free interval. So let's look into the SOLO 1, that's frontline maintenance. It's significant, again, unmet need. We don't know what to do when the patient relapses. Okay, and the 10 to 18 months we can get by bevacizumab. As of now in our ESI hospital, those who fail, we give a second line chemo and try to maintain it with bevacizumab, which is available. But definitely 70 of them will relapse, and there's a significant need for a better frontline to improve the outcomes in these patients. And that was SOLO 1, advanced tumors with germline mutation. And it's a multi-center phase 3 study, looked into again olaparib, wanted to see the overall survival, progression-free survival, and the response rate. And if you see the curve at the end of third year, 60% of progression-free at the end of third year was reported. And again, it was significant, and there is a reduced the risk of progression by almost 70% in the olaparib arm. If you see the median follow-up went up to 41 months compared to 13 months in the placebo arm. So that was a definite improvement in the progression. Now, what do we do with when the BRCA mutation was seen and patient continued to derive benefit?
And in a country, if your BRCA was mutated, yes, the amount of benefit was much higher. And the median follow-up of olaparib was 4.8 years, and with the placebo, 5 years. And you see that the definitely 48% compared to 21% in the placebo arm. So there was consistent benefit seen across all these subgroups. And if you see here, all the points are towards whether you take it, what is the baseline CA125 value, what is DIPOM mutation, age of the patient, disease status, and how long she or he was event free. All pointed out that there is a massive residual macroscopic disease, no residual macroscopic disease, all pointed out in a favoring the arm which is having the olaparib. The 50% reduction in the risk of second progression of death was also observed, and that olaparib maintained and did not diminish the benefit conferred by continuing next line of therapy. So that's the curve showing. Now let's look into the efficacy of the olaparib beyond the range of our endpoints. And you see the red line, which corresponds to the olaparib. And so there was a prolongation definitely. Most interventions were managed through dose modification without the need of intervention. So relatively safer drug where we don't need to stop the drug for the patient, but yes, you can reduce the dose of the drug and continue it rather than discontinuation. Discontinuation, if you see the chart, it's only 10 to 11%. And the if you see the dose discontinuation over or the decrease in the dose of the drug across the last 2 years, the blue line says that the dose was 300 BD, that's the original dose, and the orange is 250, the gray is 200, and very small portion had to be changed the drug. The most common AE was seen gastrointestinal, and I told you a little bit of nausea.
Anita, 2 more minutes.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Asthenia, anemia is seen. And thus treating with parpofarin can you have a future therapy? Yes, yeah. Both the olaparib was not reached when we went in to see to the overall survival, but definitely there's an intent to treat. And I think that's the last slide. Maintenance olaparib led to substantial unpredicted improvement in progression-free survival when a newly diagnosed advanced ovarian cancer with BRCA mutation with a difference in median progression-free survival extending even up to 3 years. 70% risk reduction is seen in those who were treated with olaparib. Median follow-up reached up to 41 months when the olaparib arm compared to only 13 months, that is approximately a year in the placebo arm. The reduction in the risk of second progression and death was observed, demonstrating that olaparib maintenance does not diminish the benefit of subsequent therapy. It's quite a reasonably safe drug, and there was no decrease in the quality of life from the baseline over 24 months of period of. Thank you very much. So this is quite a promising drug. We don't have it in our hospital. Yes, we are hoping to have it in future with us. And anybody wants any question, I'm free to ask the questions. Thank you very much.
Fantastic and informative presentation, madam. Madam, you can enter. Mohanambal, madam.
Chalamali. I'll carry on. Thank you, madam, for finishing in time. Now, next speaker is going to be our Dr. Chalamba. She is associate professor attached to our ESI Medical College. She did her MBBS in Chengalpattu Medical College, MD in Madurai. She was very much interested in laparoscopic surgery, learned from PG Park. After she joined ESI Medical College for the past 3 years, she has done tremendous laparoscopic surgery. Over to you, Dr. Chalamba. She will be talking about the borderline tumor of ovarian tumor. Over to you, Chalamba.
Good afternoon, expected organizers. I thank you for the nice introduction, ma'am. And good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible to everyone? Yeah, my topic for discussion today is borderline ovarian tumors. And I'll not be boring you too much. Please don't worry, because we have learned a lot about invasive ovarian cancer. And now my discussion will be how a borderline ovarian tumor is different from an invasive ovarian carcinoma and how that we have to approach. So by definition, there are distinct pathological group of neoplasms that demonstrate higher proliferative activity when compared with benign neoplasms, but that do not show stromal invasion. They can also be called as tumors of low malignant potential. The main important a good feature of borderline ovarian tumor is they carry a very good prognosis. They present in younger women, mainly in the reproductive age group of 20 to 40, and they commonly come to presentation at an initial stage at stage one, where it carries a 5-year survival rate of about 97% to 98%. And almost a 10-year survival rate comes around 70 to 80% for the borderline ovarian tumors. They can also be called as tumors of low malignancy, they are called as tumors of low malignant potential. Going on to the historical background, this was first described by Howard C. Taylor, where he used the term semi-malignant tumors to label the subset of large ovarian tumors because it had an indolent course with relatively favorable outcome despite the presence of peritoneal disease. So till 1971, they were not considered a distinct entity. Then FIGO and WHO established a separate borderline category of tumors. Since then, considerable controversy has surrounded the definition and management of borderline ovarian tumor because of their enigmatic pathogenesis and confusing biological behavior. So this is relatively uncommon. The incidence of borderline ovarian tumor is relatively uncommon. Many gynecologists that we come across is at least one case in a year when we operate general gynec cases. And they constitute 10 to 15% of all epithelial ovarian neoplasms. They're typically seen in younger age group than their invasive counterparts. Almost 1/3 of this borderline ovarian tumors present in women less than 40 years old. So whenever we see ovarian cyst, which has got a complex feature on ultrasonogram in a younger woman, the first suspicion should be for us is could be a borderline ovarian tumor, and we should plan the management accordingly, planning for a frozen section intraoperatively and to decide for further management. This carries an excellent prognosis as they're often diagnosed at an earlier stage, as it has been told already. Risk factors and genetics. These risk factors are similar to those recognized for invasive ovarian cancer, as we say, Paris women are protective against development of ovarian cancer. And again, lactation is a protective factor of ovarian cancer. The thing is, unlike invasive ovarian cancer, oral contraceptive use is not protective against the development of borderline ovarian tumor. And Dr. Kavita Sugumaran ma'am has wonderfully told about the genetics of this ovarian cancer. And here, I just want to put a point here. The women with mutations of BRCA genes, are not at increased risk for development of borderline ovarian tumor. There's no evidence to show this BRCA gene inheritance do not have an increased risk for the development of BOD. This borderline ovarian tumor, which can also be called as a tumors of low malignant potential, are characterized by the mutations of BRAF or KRAS pathway. Although this can progress to invasive disease, this tends to be of a low-grade invasive phenotype rather than high-grade, because of which it carries an excellent prognosis. And going on to the histological features, it is almost same as that we see for an epithelial ovarian cancer. It is a serous, which constitutes about 50% of borderline ovarian tumors, and it can be micropapillary and microinvasive. Mucinous, they constitute 46% of BOD, and it can be intestinal endocervical mullerian. Very rare variant, which constitutes 4%, is endometrioid, clear cell, Brenner, mixer. While this borderline endometrioid, clear cell, Brenner, and correctly diagnosed mucinous borderline tumors usually behave in a benign fashion, the serous and seromucinous have a distinct behavior which is not always benign. They say when we see a borderline ovarian tumor, the histology coming as a serous borderline tumor after the specimen, after the final specimen, then it should be treated like an invasive ovarian tumor because they do not always behave benign like an ovarian tumor, like a borderline ovarian tumor. It's a picture of a serous ovarian tumor. The serous borderline tumor are associated with peritoneal lesions that are called termed implants. These implants can either be non-invasive implants or an invasive implants. This non-invasive implant is just a confined to peritoneal mesothelial line surface and they lack invasion of the underlying tissue. Whereas this invasive implant, they just get invaded to the underlying bowel, omentum, fat or muscle structure. So WHO 2014 classification recommends that lesions with invasive implants be designated as a low-grade serous ovarian carcinoma, and the management has to be accordingly. This is a picture of a mucinous which shows the mucin secreting cells. And this mucinous borderline tumor is typically seen as a unilateral tumor, large tumor, which assumes a size of about 18 to 20 centimeter. Typically, it is like confined to one ovary. There is no well documented cases of this mucinous borderline tumor with implants. The main important feature of this mucinous borderline tumor is, as a very large and typically heterogeneous, adequate sampling has to be done thoroughly in all areas of this tumor to rule out occult foci of carcinoma, because some area may harbor occult foci of carcinoma, and final interpretation can be a borderline ovarian tumor when actually they could be an invasive ovarian carcinoma. This is the main important finding that we gynecologists to have it in mind when we approach a mucinous borderline ovarian tumor. And this is the histological feature. And gross appearance is primary ovarian borderline tumor. As been already told, this typical serous borderline ovarian tumor, they can be bilateral in 30% of the cases. And this micropapillary, they are bilateral in 75% of the cases. Mucinous, intestinal, endocervical, they are unilateral, assume a larger size. Endometrioid, clear cell, Brenner, or rare variants. And the types of this ovarian borderline tumor, serous borderline tumor, 70% of the cases do present in stage 1 and survival is almost 100%. 30% we see the serous borderline tumor in advanced stages and survival is 95.3% if there is non-invasive implant. Presence of invasive implant alters the prognosis greatly. And mucinous tumor, again, it could be an intestinal type and the Müllerian subtype. Intestinal subtype is, as told, it is unilateral, and they can be 10% of situations they can be associated with pseudomyxoma peritonei. When it is associated with pseudomyxoma peritonei, thorough inspection of the GI tract with appendix should be made. At a special attention to appendix should be considered, and appendicectomy during the primary surgery or when you consider a relook surgery, it should be considered, appendicectomy to be considered. And this endometrioid clear cell Brenner variant or rare variants, all these runs a benign course with a high survival rates. Diagnosis, most common we gynecologists diagnose borderline tumor after this specimen, the histology of a specimen, like we operate for a presumed benign condition and the specimen report comes to us, we do either a cystectomy or we do a ovarotomy, a salping ovarotomy, and the final histology of the specimen is being reported as borderline ovarian tumor. This is how commonly gynecologists do come across a borderline ovarian tumor. The important finding that I would like to stress here is, whenever you see a complex ovarian cyst in young women, complexity of the cyst, as we know, it could be characterized by the presence of multiloculation, 6 septations, a solid areas, intracystic papillary projection, always keep in mind it could be a case of a borderline ovarian tumor, and please arrange for a frozen section intraoperatively, and based on the frozen section, the further surgery can be modified. And it is more likely to be asymptomatic and diagnosed as an incidental finding or at a routine examination. Those who present with symptoms have it for a longer duration. Same like invasive ovarian cancer, they can present like a pelvic pain, bloating, dyspareunia, menstrual irregularities, and pressure symptoms. Investigations, transvaginal ultrasound is the first line of investigation as we commonly employ for any suspected ovarian cyst. And tumor markers, CA-125 can be elevated in 70% of this serous borderline tumors. 99 can be elevated in mucinous borderline tumor. As we know, color Doppler can differentiate the intracystic blood flow and can differentiate a benign and malignant condition. MRI can tell about the presence of peritoneal and extra-ovarian lesions. Biomarkers, CA-125 do not aid in diagnosis or follow-up care in borderline ovarian tumor. Again, as this borderline ovarian tumor do present commonly in a premenopausal younger age group, this calculation of RMA ROMA is not useful in predicting borderline ovarian tumor. DNA cytometry can be performed. If we have the facility, it can be performed in biopsy specimen, because if the tumor has happened to be a euploid tumor, it carries an excellent prognosis. And management is individualized. And it depends mainly on the age of the women, the stage of the disease, the potential desire of the pregnancy. As we know, it commonly presents in young women. The desire for future fertility is a main important determinant in assessing, in planning of a surgery. And what is the nature of peritoneal implants? It happened to be an invasive implant, and naturally it will behave like an invasive ovarian cancer, and the management has to be designed appropriately. And this borderline ovarian tumor, whenever you get a histology, referral to a cancer center, I input from a multidisciplinary team involving a gynae oncologist should be there. And we have to assess the women has got a desire to retain fertility. If she has a desire to retain fertility and if the tumor is supposed to be in early stage, conservative surgery can be employed in this group of population. If it is an advanced stage, after thorough counseling of the women and the presence of invasive implant, you can consider a completing surgery or a follow-up or a conservative surgery or a close follow-up. Even in the presence of advanced stage and the invasive implant, when the women strongly desires for a future fertility and is willing for regular follow-up, the women can be offered for a conservative surgery because this borderline ovarian tumor takes a long time progress to invasive tumor. And even if it progresses to invasive tumor, it will be of a low invasive type and it is completely surgically resectable. And if the women do not have a desire for a future fertility, it's better that we complete surgery and put the women on a close follow. And once a woman undergoes a complete surgery, the follow-up remains questionable here. So in a suspicion of a borderline tumor, appropriate primary surgery is essential. Appropriate primary surgery, that is what I'm trying to tell us, an accurate staging and cytoreductive surgery where appropriate. Accurate staging, inspection of all peritoneal surfaces involving the bowel, the omentum, and the contralateral ovary should be there. If the primary surgery is done appropriately, the need for completion surgery and the follow-up will be relatively reduced and the stress of the women will also be greatly reduced. And if the frozen section is reported as borderline ovarian tumor, the women is an older
woman
and do not have any
desire for minutes.
It's better we do a it's better to do completion surgery there. Exploration of the cavity, completion surgery is same as the staging laparotomy you do for an invasive carcinoma. Entire cavity, bilateral salping ovariectomy, appendicectomy in case of mucinous tumor. Hysterectomy has no value in complete staging of borderline ovarian tumor and should be considered if the patient wishes for cytoreduction or if the uterus is involved with invasive disease. And as I told, the further management after primary surgery is mainly dependent on histology of the tumor, grade of the tumor, stage of the disease, DNA ploidy status, fertility preferences, and mainly on the completeness of the primary surgery. And the role of restaging complete surgery, it is recommended in women with micropapillary tumors in the presence of invasive implants. If the invasive implant is there, then the risk of recurrence is high, 31% versus 21% over 5 years. And DNA aneuploidy is seen in the tumor. Again, it carries a 90-fold increased risk in subsequent risk of dying. Definitely, it needs a restaging. Restaging will include peritoneal washings, omentectomy, complete examination with or without hysterectomy. There is no benefit of lymphadenectomy as we do in invasive ovarian cancer. And role of conservative surgery in subsequent fertility. So this is defined as complete staging with preservation of uterus. At least a part of one ovary should be there to preserve fertility. The options of a conservative surgery could be cystectomy, unilateral salping or oophorectomy, with or without infracolic omentectomy and peritoneal washings. Biopsy of normal contralateral ovary is not recommended as it may create adhesions and may impair future fertility. The relapse rate after cystectomy could be 12 to 58%. Salping oophorectomy could be 0 to 20. Radical surgery, the relapse rate is very less. Several studies have shown that it do not have any impact on the conception rate following surgery for a borderline ovarian tumor. Many of the women do conceive spontaneously, 50% tumor, and the spontaneous fertility rate is 32 to 65%. Small studies have shown the recurrence rate following fertility treatment, mainly ovulation induction, the clomiphene and IVF. But this is also more in favor of the nature of the conservative surgery being performed, not of the impact of the fertility drugs that we use. But anyway, fertility specialists do recommend limitation of the number of cycles of induction in a case of borderline ovarian tumor. The role of laparoscopy staging and treatment of BOT should ideally be performed in midline laparotomy. From a gynecologist point of view, they say early stages, small volume masses, and in the absence of extensive peritoneal implants, laparoscopic management is as safe as laparotomy. And role of chemotherapy, no role for adjuvant chemotherapy. may be given in recurrent bout, not amenable to surgical resection, because surgery remains a mainstay of treatment in relapse of bout. Follow-up is very essential after fertility sparing surgery. Relapse is uncommon in those who have had both ovaries removed. Risk of recurrence varies from 0 to 58%. The follow-up is mainly by clinical examination and transvaginal ultrasound. There is no value in routine CA-125 based follow-up. Every 3 months for the first 2 years, every 6 months for the next 2 years, and annually thereafter. So these are my references. Thank you for having given me this chance.
Thank you, Chalana, for finishing in time. Actually, the borderline tumor, 2000 HERA, we are very lucky enough to have ultrasonogram for each and every tumor. In the 80s, we have got so many great teachers who used to teach us ovarian tumor so much. They all landed up with secondaries. They've gone to the orthopedic surgeon for spondylitis. Another one gone for tuberculosis with the secondaries. So nowadays, because each and every person, small thing also, they take the ultrasonogram. As a PG's take-home message, any tumor more than 6 cm, always think in terms of borderline malignancy and go ahead with that. That is the main key point today is verify. Apart from that, try to do the all investigation, whichever the modality is available, non-invasive. Because we have got all the modalities available everywhere with the free of cost also, as well as the cost is very minimal compared to the life expectancy. Those days, unless the tumor is so big, after the secondaries only, they land up to the gyne department. That's why either go to gastroenterology department or ortho department for low backache or neck pain or the dyspepsia. Now, over to Dr. Sabat Kumar, please.
Yes, madam. Thank you. Our last speaker, but important topic on fertility preservation options, is Dr. Maya Menon. She's the professor and HOD of ESI KK Nagar, and she has done the medical education advanced course and has got the best paper award. She is the member of FOXI ESAR, and she has undergone training in lab and ultrasound. She has presented papers and faculty in many national and international conferences. Back to Dr. Maya. Dr. Maya?
Yeah. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes.
So I hope everyone have... Yeah, I'll start my talk. My talk is on fertility preservation options in ovarian cancer. See, advances in cancer diagnosis and therapeutics have improved the prognosis and quality of life in survivors, especially the adolescent and those of the reproductive age group. And we have found that the age group less than 44 years, the risk of ovarian cancer is about 12.1%. And the 5-year survival in women less than 44 years of age is 91.2% when found at stage 1A and stage 1B. Fertility preservation is a challenge for this group of patients. And most patients, it is salpingoophorectomy or hysterectomy followed by radiotherapy, chemotherapy, which causes loss of reproductive function. Fertility preservation is usually done in early stage epithelial ovarian cancer, borderline ovarian cancer, germ cell tumor, and granulosa cell tumor. Fertility preservation depends on the time before surgery, chemo, or neoadjuvant therapy. It also depends on the time and the stage of malignancy. It also depends on the pubertal status and also if there is a partner, preservation of the partner's semen sample. How does chemotherapeutic agents affect the ovarian reserve and how to manage? Chemotherapeutic agents have a cytotoxic effect on the ovaries, inducing apoptosis and negatively affect the hypothalamo-pituitary axis, which is also dose dependent. So to prevent gonadotoxicity, hormonal protective agents, which act on the hypothalamo-pituitary ovarian axis, causes downregulation so that the ovarian tissue enters into a state of inactivity, thus making them less susceptible to the cytotoxic agents. Fertility sparing methods are the ovarian tissue cryopreservation. Here, the normal ovarian tissue is removed, and the ovarian tissue can sometimes have malignant cells, PCR or spectrophotometry P53 mutation studies is done to make sure that the ovarian tissue has no malignant cell. It is preserved and after the treatment, transplant the ovarian tissue. This was done first in 1999 in sheep. Then later in human, it was done in 2004 by Donas et al. They transplanted the ovarian tissue into the ovarian fossa, the broad ligament or the pelvic peritoneum. Ovarian activity was seen after 4 months after transplantation. And it is found, the studies show that about 120 babies are born by way of ovarian tissue cryopreservation so far. Oocyte cryopreservation, oocyte is retrieved from unaffected ovary during surgery with or without ovarian hyperstimulation. Controlled ovarian hyperstimulation and intraoperative oocyte collection was followed by cryopreservation. Open method is used for oocyte retrieval as transvaginal approach causes capsule rupture and leak of malignant cells. Oocytes are retrieved at mature or immature stage. Oocyte cryopreservation is here the oocyte is acquired while doing a unilateral ovarectomy. Controlled ovarian hyperstimulation is not done in granulosa cell tumor. Oocyte is acquired either in the immature or mature stage when we require an early intervention or if it is done in a prepubertal age group. Immature oocyte is matured in vitro before freezing or thawing. It's said that because of this cryopreservation and freezing and thawing, there could be death of some oocytes which are preserved. That's why they have said that if the age of the mother is less than 38 years of age, at least 8 oocytes are required. And if it is more than 38 years of age, more than 8 oocytes are required. Embryo cryopreservation. It was done in 1983. It is done in women with no therapeutic urgency for at least 2 to 3 weeks for ovarian stimulation. Here the male partner or a male gamete donor is required. Vitrification technique is used for the storage of the embryo for 2 to 3 years. Photoprotective agents. They offer protection against germ cell damage. They are the GnRH agonist and antagonist, sphingosine 1-phosphate, imatinib, mesalate, amifositin and tamoxifen. Imatinib, how does it act? It protects the oocytes from blocking the CAB1 molecule in oocyte death pathway caused by cisplatin. And amifositin protects the apoptosis in oocyte against cyclophosphamide. GnRH antagonists and agonists cause temporary ovarian suppression. Apoptosis inhibition occurs. It's usually used in patients who receive treatment for breast or ovarian cancer, thus protecting them from premature ovarian failure. 50% decreased risk of premature ovarian failure is seen. 60% increased rate of recovery of menses was seen and increase in odds ratio of pregnancy by 60%. What is the future? One is the in vitro ovarian follicle growth. Why was it thought of? This is because it's found that some cryopreserved ovarian tissue, autotransplantation has the risk of tumor reimplantation and dissemination. And also, this was thought about in prepubertal girls who no need for ovarian stimulation. On these two scenarios, this method of in vitro ovarian follicle growth was thought of and it is under process. Here, the immature oocytes are cultured in vitro to produce metaphase stage 2 oocyte and it is later used for IVF. In vitro ovarian follicle maturation. Portion of the ovarian cells from the patient with cancer is treated with phosphatase, tensin homologue inhibitor or AKT activator. And in vitro follicle maturation is done. These follicles are later used in future. The latest is the artificial ovary, which has been started from 2016 by Scori et al. And Paulini et al. Developing an ovarian matrix to support the follicle oocyte development have been shown and some advances is going on in this particular field. So after some time, you can also hear about this artificial ovary available. Recommendations requirement for fertility sparing surgeries are: the patient should be stage 1A or stage 1C, grade 1-2, epithelial ovarian cancer, non-clear cell carcinoma, germ cell tumors, granulosa cell tumors, borderline epithelial ovarian cancer. Thorough examination of the abdominal pelvic cavity was performed at the time of surgery. Plan to pursue fertility with a reasonable chance of pregnancy. That is, the patient should be less than 40 years of age and adequate ovarian reserve should be there. Patient should be fully informed and accept both the oncological and obstetrical risk. And there should be no genetic ovarian cancer syndrome. And such patients, they should be on close follow-up and follow-up till the completion of family, and later complete surgery should be done in these patients. Fertility preservation unit consists of a good counseling team, robust ART technique, long-standing ART team, empathetic organizational support, a cooperative patient and relative support is required. So I conclude that the 5-year survival rate of stage 1 and 1B is about 90%, stage 2 is 70%, stage 3 is about 40%, stage 4 is 17%. Low-grade serous and endometrial cancer has good prognosis. Annual pelvic ultrasound is advised for those who are predisposed to develop ovarian cancer. BRCA mutated patients require close monitoring. Early diagnosis and fertility sparing surgeries are the only chance for affected women who wants to become pregnant. Hysterectomized patients should think of surrogacy, as uterine transplantation requires immunosuppression where there is risk for cancer recurrence and vascular abnormalities after pelvic irradiation. Malignant mixed Mullerian tumors are rare with poor prognosis, but patients with malignant mixed Mullerian tumors are not candidates for fertility sparing surgery. Finally, I conclude saying that fertility preservation options will depend on stage, type, and location of cancer, collaboration with a multidisciplinary team of gynecologists, oncologists, embryologists, and reproductive endocrinologists is necessary. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Ma'am, you'll have to unmute your mic.
Now, I call upon Dr. Rajeshwari R for telling the vote of thanks.
I, on behalf of the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, ESIPGIMSR, KK Nagar, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all speakers for gracing this occasion and sharing your views on ovarian cancer updates. I extend my special thanks to our Dean Madam and to our HOD, Dr. Maya Madam, for providing us with this wonderful opportunity and guiding us throughout. I also wish to express my gratitude to Dr. Sampath Kumari Madam and Dr. Mohanambal Ma'am for chairing this session. Further, I am grateful to Dr. Kavita Sukumar Ma'am, Dr. Karthikeyan Sir, Dr. Anita Ramesh Ma'am for sharing their updated views. I would also like to acknowledge my gratitude to Dr. Chellamal Madam, Dr. Gayatri, Dr. Anita for giving an excellent coverage on ovarian cancer topics. Finally, Freedom from Cancer Organization and AstraZeneca, you have supported us in this endeavor. We thank you immensely for that. And a special thanks to our IT people for being with us. And last but not the least, without you participants, this webinar would not have become a success. So thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I thank Yeah, I thank everyone for attending this webinar, and I actually thank the Dean Madam. I thank the chairpersons, Sampat Kumari Madam and Mohan Ambal Madam. Personally, I thank both of them. And I also thank Kavita Madam for sharing her knowledge, and also Karthikeyan Sir and Anita Ramesh Madam. It was a great opportunity, and this is one of our first webinar we have organized, and I'm very happy that there was overwhelming response for it. We have got about 80 or 85 entries, and I think all the speakers were very informative, and I think this conference was very informative for all of you, and I thank you once again.
Thank you.